when God has set me free.
God has set me free.
Oh, somebody tell
so
me.
So why should I be bound when?
When Jesus died for you and me.
Jesus died for you and me.
Yeah. Here's what he did.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Good morning, good morning. Hallelujah. Let us all stand as we begin our morning worship. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. Come on and put your hands together and bless the Lord. Yes, yes, yes. We welcome you this morning to the worship service streaming live from Concord Baptist Church in Milton, Massachusetts, where the Reverend Dr. Conley and Hughes Jr. serves as our senior pastor. We are so delighted that you have decided to worship with us on today, and we pray that this service will be a blessing and an inspiration to you. Amen. Amen. So come on and praise the Lord. Come on and worship the Lord. Come on and magnify the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 On this New Generation Sunday, let us prepare our hearts as we continue in worship. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Let us declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among the people. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Amen. Amen. Assisting in worship today, we have Sister Madison Davis, who will give us our invocation, followed by scripture by Brother Dominic Culbreth. Amen. Let us put our hands together for our young people. Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you. If we all bow our heads in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning and starting us on this beautiful Sunday to church. I pray that throughout this church service that we are blessed with what our pastor has to say. Like Miss Yvonne has taught about the junior vessels, we always take it from God, learn it, and then we give it to the people. So I pray today, as we go to the church service, that we all are blessed, covered. I pray for people who are in need or homeless. I pray that God makes a way for them to come through. I also pray for everybody in the church. I pray that as we leave, that we get home safely, definitely, so that we can come back on Sunday to praise the Lord again. I also pray that if there's any natural disasters, that the church is covered, that every church is covered. So anywhere we are, we can always praise the Lord, whenever, wherever. I pray for the people who are also live streaming. And I pray for everybody in this entire world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But deliver us from
scripture lesson is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 8, New International Version. As the body of Christ, let us read God's word together. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received is passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and on the 12th. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last, he appeared to me, also abnormally born. May the Lord add a blessing to this reading and of his word.
Amen. Bless the name of Jesus. If you want to stand, keep standing. But we want you to put your hands together. Come on, come on. Let the glory of the Lord. rise among us. Let it rise.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. He said, if I be lifted up, then I will draw all men, women, boy, and girl unto me. Come on, we come out today to worship him. Let's give God some praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our God is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Thank you, Minister Mills, anointed praise. Give the Lord high praise. We're blessed this morning. We're blessed this morning on Generation Sunday. We want to introduce to you our new JV, our new junior vessels. Amen. Come on, give the Lord praise. This is our new generation. Our generation rising of our new vessels. Give the Lord praise. Amen. This is our generation rising. Amen. Our new generation vessels. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. As they minister to us this morning.
Good morning, church. So excited for our junior vessels today. Amazing. So our junior vessels today will, they have been learning how to, one, learn about dance. And one of the things that they learned of how, and I heard Maddie in her prayer, which I'm glad you're doing your thing back there. She's learned how, they're learning how to receive from God, right? Get the drop from the God, from God. Yes. Give it to us, and he gives to the people. All right? So they know today that they're serving you now. All right. Because they've already received from God. Amen. Yes? Yes? So today's ministry is just about us having gifts, right? God gives us gifts as a pastor. He gives us gifts as a singer, musician, the music booth back there, the treasurer. He gives us all gifts, right? But they become an idol when we don't serve God with our gifts. Amen? Amen. So we have a few actors here. So Natalie, can you stand? So Natalie, she is a businesswoman, okay? And Jave is a basketball player. And we have Liana, she's a schoolgirl, so she's very smart. And then we have Nini, who is she's a singer, right? And we have Rose, she's just gifted from God. She gets all the money. She gets all the money. Okay? So just enjoy the piece and look at yourselves. When you look at this piece, look at yourselves and say, oh God, you've given me this gift. I must serve you. And no matter who you are, no, the age, no matter who you are, okay? All right, so I think we're ready.
There's a voice that cries out in the silence, searching for a heart that will love him, longing for a child that will give him their all. Give it all, he wants it all. And there's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate, and longing for a child that will give him their all. Give it all, he wants it all. And he says, love me with your whole heart. He wants it all today. Serve me with your life now. He wants it all today. Bow down, let go of your idols. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all today, he wants it all. There's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate, longing for a child that will give him their all. Give it all, he wants it all. all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all. Child that will give him their all, give it all. He wants it all.
All minds clear. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for letting us give this peace to you. We thank you for making us feel welcome to present. We thank you, God, for giving us this peace. And we ask that you help us to not use our gifts as an idol. We ask that we return our gifts to you, because you gave these gifts to us, but just as quick as you gave it to us is just as quick as how you can take it away. And we ask that if we do idolize ourselves, we ask that you help us to get us in the right mind, to just keep us in your path, because we know how you just give things to us, but when we pray and all these other things, we try to make it on our time. When it's not our time, we should be waiting on. We do things on your time. Because when we do things on your time, things will go right for us. We can't rush you. Even if we try to, you wouldn't go any faster. So we thank you for helping all of us to see that our gifts are not to be used as idols. They're to be used to be given back to you. In Jesus' name I do pray, amen.
Question: are we willing to give God our all? Right?
It was a beautiful reminder, but we still have a responsibility within ourselves to reflect. Are we giving God our all? Are we taking the gifts that He has given us and using them to glorify the Father? Or are we taking those things to glorify ourselves? Let us be mindful as we move forward in life. Amen? You had something?
Hi, I also wanted to acknowledge Maddie. Maddie, she represented God, okay? And God wanted to sit in the presence, like He wants to sit in your presence with your gifts. But also God, born of a man, he took off Himself and placed it on our sins so that way we could represent Him in beauty and holiness. Amen? So I just wanted to represent Maddie as well. Amen?
Amen. Thank you, Sister Yvonne, for that clarity. Many of us that were watching, you saw how she took off her robe. Maddie took her robe off and put it over the gifts that they had been given to God to glorify Him. And at the end, those were lifted and escorted out. Amen? Hallelujah. Make sure that we're looking for the message and the artistry. We are not being entertained. We are being ministered to. Amen? So there is a message. Praise God. Okay, I'm up here for April accomplishments. I'm over here talking. Praise God. So we have quite a few accomplishments for our youth. The first one is Marcus Daly Jr. Praise God. Is a second semester junior at Howard University. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He has been on the dean's list for the last 2 academic years. He has earned straight A's for the first semester and is on his way to maintaining straight A's again during his second semester. Praise God. Hallelujah. Marcus has also been named as a costume designer for the Howard Players, a student-run theater organization at Howard University. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Many of us may remember Marcus ministering in the arts here as a child. He was ministering in mime. He was ministering in dance. God had already planted that inside of him so that he would receive the glory. So we thank God for what He's doing in our brother Marcus Daly. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now for the Devons, is Joshua and Josiah Devon here? Joshua Devon made the JH5 AAU travel basketball team. Congratulations, Joshua. Amen. Josiah Devon was accepted to the Dance Theater of Harlem Summer Intensive Program. Hallelujah. We praise God for His doings in our youth and artistry. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Joy Gant, a junior, has earned 5 A's, 1 B, and 1 C in honors pre-calculus. Amen. Hallelujah. She is currently traveling overseas in Europe for cultural enrichment with her school. We praise traveling mercies. We are so proud of you, Joy. Praise God. Next, we have Robert Sims. Received the President Award at Roxbury Community College. Congratulations, Robert. Okay, and so we have 3 more accomplishments. These accomplishments were shared by Brother James Cooley regarding his great-grandchildren who live in Worcester. First, we have Aaron, a junior at Brown University with 3.8 GPA on a full academic and athletic scholarship. Amen. Praise God for provision in the name of Jesus. We have Bryce, has never made a grade below 90% in his 8 years of school. He's been invited to be inducted in the National Honor Society. Also, he was awarded a certificate of excellence from the Black Excellence Academy of Worcester. Congratulations, Bryce. And then lastly, we have Brooklyn, is an honor roll student. She campaigned and was selected as her class president at her elementary school. She also is an all-star basketball player. Praise God for our youth. Amen. Hallelujah.
Please send your child's accomplishments to youth@cbcboston.org. We'd love to hear from you. No accomplishment is too small. May God bless you today.
Praise God. Thank you, Minister Walifa. And let's give praise for all of our young people. Amen. God be praised. I also want to give a shout out to Madison and Dominique. They led us in our worship this morning, in our responsive reading, our prayer. Amen. And thank you, Minister Walika, and for Reverend Gant and all of your team that does so well. Amen. All of our team that does so well with all of our youth and our children's church. And we're just delighted at what the Lord is doing with this generation that is present with us, and they are rising. Amen. Amen. Deacon Paisley comes with very briefly this morning, and then we'll proceed on with the offering. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord. I just would like to add on this morning to all the accolades to someone who is not young, but young in heart, our pastor. As you know, Pastor turned 70 years old back in October. And let's give God praise for our pastor. You know, Deuteronomy 20:28-3 reminds us, you are blessed in the city, you are blessed in the field. And Deuteronomy 8:28-6 reminds us, you will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. And Pastor, while you were away this week on business in Pennsylvania, you received an award or recognition. And let's give God praise for traveling mercies for our pastor. Because God is so good. And isn't it good to know that he will bless us before we even arrive somewhere? He's got a blessing that's waiting for us. So, Pastor, this is recognition from the Boston Police. It's a special citation. Amen. And it reads, Reverend Dr. Conley Hughes, in grateful appreciation for your 35 years of dedicated service to the Concord Baptist Church. Amen. Of Boston, your congregation and communities across the region, as you celebrate your 70th birthday, thank you for your efforts to improve the lives of youth and the quality of life in our communities. Your life's work and vocation has supported and guided many in need to a better path. The Boston Police Department is honored to wish you health, wellness, and continued success and happiness as you continue in your ministry. Michael A. Cox, Police Commissioner. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Amen.
You're welcome.
And I want to thank God for Boston's finest. Amen. All of our police officers, the men and women who serve so faithfully, and all that they're doing to provide us with safety in our city and in our communities. Amen. And especially so here in Boston, which is the capital city for the Commonwealth. Amen. And I want to thank God for Commissioner Cox, whose mother was so instrumental in the life and ministry here at Concord Church. Amen. And many of you know she served so faithfully, was our church financial secretary at one point, was a faithful trustee, and also served in our senior choir at one point. So we have fond memories of Mother Bertha Cox. Amen. She would be so proud of her son being the commissioner of police for the city of Boston. But on behalf of all of the officers and the command staff and all of the members of the Boston City Police, we thank you for your kindness and your generosity.
are so undeserved on my part. Thank you. Good morning, church. We welcome all who are here. We have persons visiting. Would you please stand at this time if you are visiting this morning? We'd like to acknowledge you. Amen. Amen. Wherever you are, please remain standing. God bless you. Remain standing. And just a moment there, our ushers will bring you a card. But on that card, I think, is a heart. And lift that heart lifts right off. Place it somewhere so that you will know that you are loved by us. You come only once as a guest. You leave as a new what? Friend. And I dare say a continuing friend. And we are praying for you. If you are visiting from another church, we're praying for your shepherd of your flock, the angel of your house, as well as your church family. If you do not have a church home, we want to invite you to consider becoming a member here at Concord Church. Amen. And we are an inviting people, people of the word, being discipled and empowered through the Holy Spirit. Amen. So looking forward to personally greeting you for just a moment. I know we all have our schedules after church, but before we make a mad dash, just want to say hello. Amen. God bless you so much. You may be seated. I want to also thank God. I saw Brother Barry Ford in the house today. Amen. Grateful to see him here today. Has returned from Brazil, and so grateful to have him here back at home. Amen. As we continue, I want to thank you for your continuing prayers as we persevere in Jesus' name. And we want you to listen to our announcements today. Always an opportunity to learn what we are attempting to do here at Concord Church, not only to empower ourselves as believers, but also to certainly take our ministry beyond our campus, amen, where the need is, amen. God has called us to go forth. The Bible describes Christians as the church gathered and the church scattered, amen. So wherever we go, we must be a witness of the love of Jesus Christ. And I want to thank all of our ministries and our members for being that witness. It warms my heart when I travel. I was in King of Prussia, Pennsylvania last week with the American Baptist Home Mission Society, and ran into people from all across the country, including Puerto Rico, and people knew someone who was affiliated with Concord Church and spoke so fondly of how the prayers of Concord Church had blessed them in so many ways. Give God praise for this witness. Amen. It's good. It's good to know that our faith is not just to stay with us, stuck to us. Amen. But our faith should be used as a witness for Christ's love. Amen. So to that end, I want to thank you for always your support and the giving of your tithes and offerings, and all of your time and your special gifts. The ushers are going to come, and we're so grateful today for this New Generation Sunday as we share in our offering. Remember that we have a special offering, second offering, only on the Sunday by Generation Sunday. We do it on Mission Sunday. But today, this second offering supports these wonderful young people. Amen. Our present emerging generation. Amen. Let's say amen for our junior ushers. Praise God. Amen. They look so wonderful, so wonderful. And let us stand, all who are able to stand, as we share in the affirmation of giving. Amen. Blessed be the name of God. Amen. Now let's share in our affirmation of giving from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. And, you know, sometimes I alternate the translations. I do that deliberately, so it's not that I'm forgetting it all the time. Notice I said all the time. But I like to alternate because I like to know that the translations are consistent with the original tongues of the language. But it's to let us know that God has a plan for us. Amen. How many believe God has a plan for your life? Amen. And how many of you know further that God will fulfill the promises he has made to us And thirdly, if we trust God, hold to him and obey him, he will fulfill those promises. Amen. So let us share in these verses in Proverbs 3, verses 8 and 9. We will honor the Lord with all of our resources. We will return to him the top portion of all that we receive. Then our lives will be filled with abundance, and we will overflow with bountiful blessings. Let's pray. Gracious and loving eternal God, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we thank you today for the privilege we have to worship together, whether in person or streaming. God, we just thank you that we are of one body. We thank you, God, that we have one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one Father who is above all, in all, and through all. We thank you for the measure of grace that you have given us. We do not take it lightly that you woke us up this morning. God, we thank you that we were able to see the beauty of the sun once again. And so, God, as we give today, we first give of ourselves. Lord, we pray that you might find us acceptable in your sight. And then we give a portion of the possessions that you have given us. We return them. We return them back to you through the ministry and the mission of our church and your kingdom. And we pray, God, that you will bless, consecrate, multiply every gift, every tithe, every offering, every act of service. And, oh, God, we pray for our brothers and our sisters who have had a difficult time financially. Lord, we know that you are able to do exceedingly abundantly, far greater than we could ever imagine, even according to the work and the faith that is in us. And so, God, we pray today that doors will be open, a way will be made. Where we're empty, we will be filled. Where we're lacking, supply will come. Oh, God, we thank you in advance. We praise you. We bless your name. This we pray according to faith. So it is, and so shall it be. In Jesus' name, shout amen. Amen and amen. And a wave offering unto the Lord. A wave offering. A thank offering unto the Lord our God. Amen. Amen. Let us receive our digital announcements. There are various ways of giving. And you may give physically as the ushers come. And you may also give electronically. Whatever is convenient for you. Thank you for those of you who've already given and those who will give this week. Amen. Amen.
The Willing Workers Ministry of Concord Church will meet next Sunday after service in the chapel. If you'd like to serve with the Willing Workers Ministry, please join them next Sunday after service in the chapel. The White Rose High School Scholarship is now accepting applications for high school seniors for fall 2024. And also the Ann Murray Bell Healthcare Professional Scholarship is accepting applications for students enrolled in a New England area accredited medical school. For full qualifications and details, visit the church's Facebook page or website. Concord Baptist Church is so excited to welcome and host the American Baptist Churches of Massachusetts TABCOM annual gathering on April 26th and 27th. The Friday night 7 p.m. and Saturday afternoon 3 p.m. worship services are open to everyone. The workshops, breakout sessions, and panels are for our registered guests and delegates. The American Baptist Churches of Massachusetts TABCOM annual gathering, April 26th and 27th, hosted by Concord Baptist Church. Join us at Concord along with the Sisters of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority as we honor Autism Acceptance Month, Sunday, April 28th at 9:45 a.m. Please save the date for our Mother's Day Prayer Breakfast, Saturday, May 18th from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. More details to come. Concord Baptist Church believes in studying the Word of God. We start on Sunday mornings beginning with Sunday school at 8:30 a.m. with classes for all ages. The Word Alive Bible Study with Pastor Hughes streams every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Join us this Tuesday as we continue the conclusion of God Never Gives Up on You, the Tuesday night Bible study with Pastor Hughes, streaming on all CBC platforms. Zoom with Reverend Dr. Maureen Hughes for the Women's Bible Study, Women Growing in God's Grace, now Zooming at 7 p.m. on Wednesdays. The teens and tweens of Concord begin Zoom Bible study on April 24th at 6 p.m., studying I Am, how Jesus revealed his identity and how it relates to who God says we are as believers in Christ. Teens and tweens Zooming I Am, beginning Wednesday, April 24th, 6 p.m. And now Zooming on Thursdays in the brother-to-brother young men's Bible studies. Fundamentals in the Faith, Zooming every Thursday at 6 p.m. Information for all of our Bible studies can be found on the church's Facebook page or website, cbcboston.org. Intercessory prayer is available to you Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Call 319-527-2961. The intercessory prayer call-in line is Wednesdays only at 6 p.m. 319-527-2961. Join us every Wednesday at 6 p.m. on the phone line only for intercessory prayer.
Access to our online, midweek, and weekend ministries and activities may be found on our Facebook page or the church's website. Just search Concord Baptist Church of Boston. On behalf of Pastors Reverend Drs. Conley and Maureen Hughes and the entire Concord Church family, God bless you and have an amazing and blessed week.
Good morning. Psalms 84:11 states, For the Lord is brighter than the brilliance of the sun, of a sunrise. Wrap himself around me like a shield. He is generous with his gifts of grace and glory. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your presence, your presentation, your mercy, and your grace. And like Minister Walika talked about in our 7 a.m. Bible study class this morning, your glory. May all the glory go to you, Lord. Lord, we want to thank you for the seal, the deal of a lifetime, for blessing us with blessings. It don't cost much, Lord. All you ask for is just to give us back a little bit, which is yours for the building of your kingdom. You ask of us to walk with dignity, the way we talk, and the way we present each other. Be in obedience to one another. You want us to just show love and kindness as you have given to us. So, Lord, we ask that you just keep on blessing us. We ask you bless those who have given of themselves. Bless those who gave today. Bless those who had the desire to give but have not at this moment. We ask for all these special blessings in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Deacon Fernandez. What a glory is our God. Amen. We serve a God of glory, God who loves us still. Thank you, beloved, for all of your giving and your gifts and for all that you do. This morning, our preacher will be Minister Joseph Smith, who's no stranger to us. Joseph has worked arduously over the years. Also, he's been one of the persons working with our teen church. And he has been a blessing to many of our teens. Amen. Give God praise. Among other things, he's worked with us in terms of our work toward evangelism, and we're just so grateful to him for all that he does with our Sunday school and in other areas. So this morning on this Generation Sunday, he's going to share a special word that will not only be, we pray, an uplift to our young people, but also an uplift to each and every one of us. Amen. How many of you know that you are standing in the need of prayer? Amen. Amen. We all need prayer. Amen. We cannot exhaust. And let's just sing just old school 1 minute, since we're intergenerational and we go forward, we go back sometime too. It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, not my mother, not my father, but me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, not my mother, not my father, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, church, it's me, me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, yes. And if you have that need for prayer this morning, in just a moment, after I've shared these few requests, I'm going to ask you to stand, if you're able to stand, as we pray. We're praying this morning for the family of, in the homegoing service of our late brother, Robert Drake, very faithful member of our Brotherhood Chorus, also with our men's ministry. His service will take place tomorrow morning here at Concord Church, Monday, April 15th. The wake will be at 10, followed by the service promptly at 11. We're asking that we would be in prayer for his daughter, Alicia, and her family, and for all of his grandchildren, all of his relatives and friends. By his request, he will be buried in a family plot in South Carolina. Amen. So we will celebrate his life here tomorrow at Concord Church. Our prayers are for Sister Pauline Andrews, who recently was in the hospital, but we're happy to report she's now at home. Amen. And we are praying for her, the improvement of her health and her continuing progress. Also, her blessed daughter, Janice, has also asked that we would pray for her. She's asking for a breakthrough in looking for housing. And we're just praying that God will open that door. Amen. Because we serve an able God. Amen. Our prayers are for the family of the late Sister Rosie Mae Davis, who passed last week. Her homegoing service will be at Concord Church on Wednesday, not of this week, of the following week, April 24th. The wake will be at 11. At 10, and the service will be at 11. We're praying for Sister Davis's family. Among her family is Sister Moselle Cowell and her grandchildren. And I received a note this morning, I think, is this Deaconess Bennett? Is this? All right. Asking that we pray for, she's having day surgery, I think tomorrow. We're asking that God will be with her. We know God has already gone before you. Amen. He's able. Will you stand, beloved, as we pray? Amen. This morning, if you're able to stand, and if you find standing difficult, it's okay. Just lift your hands slightly if that's okay with you. And we're standing today not only on behalf of ourselves, but we're standing on behalf of others for whom we have a concern, maybe some loved one. And then some of us, I always have a heart for all of us. And now and then, what drops in my spirit, I have a heart for care providers, those of you who are tending for loved ones and friends who are battling illnesses and going through various situations. And, you know, when we think of care providers, we think of physical illness. But sometimes a care provider is a person who is helping someone lean on them, who's going through a difficult time. And they just need an ear to listen to. They need someone to pray with them and pray on their behalf. So if you are any form of a caretaker this morning, just lift your hands. We're praying for you today. We know that it's not easy, but God is able. Amen. Anyone who has ever been a caretaker, lift your hand. Amen. And can you testify that God brought you through during that time? Amen. 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 I was many miles away. I was over 1,000 miles away, but I was my mother's caretaker. Amen. I was one of her caretakers and couldn't wait to get there to do all I could for her. Amen. Gracious God, as we come this morning, we give you praise and thanks for all of your blessings. Oh God, sometimes we feel that we're the least deserving of your many blessings. And yet, God, we are your children. And you have promised to never leave us nor forsake us. You have brought us, oh God, into your presence and into your family through our faith in Jesus Christ by grace. We thank you, God, that you forgave us for our sins. God, you have washed us, you've justified us. And through the atonement of Jesus on the cross, God, we are saved forever. We thank you, God, that eternity is in our view and that we have eternal security. But Lord, right now today, we're coming to first say thank you, because in spite of whatever we're going through, we say thank you, God, for being on our side. God, there are moments that for some, Lord, it seems as though what they are going through is the worst of anything. But Lord, we thank you that you are with us in and through our experiences. God, we thank you that it was in the fiery furnace you showed up and you delivered the Hebrew boys. We thank you, God, that it was through the valley of the shadows that you took David. So, God, we pray right now that in and through whatever it is, that we will know that you are with us. You're guiding us. Even when the way is dark, we thank you, God, for the light of your presence showing us the way. Oh, God, in the name of Jesus, we decree and declare, according to your word, healing in this house, deliverance in this house, a way made, God. Someone who came this morning probably have had a heavy burden, but God, we pray that you will lift that burden. God, we pray that you would make it right. You're able to do it. We know that you can do all things with people. It is impossible, but with God, all things are possible, God. God, you can heal, you can help, you can deliver, you can straighten out. God, we thank you. And God, even when the doctors give up and wring their hands, we thank you. For you are the great physician. And thank you for those whom you train to tend to us, the wonderful nurses and the nurses' assistants and the doctors. And Lord, all the people, Lord, who are in the ecosystem of healthcare. But God, we know that as good as they are, they're only attending physicians, attending nurses. But you, God, you, oh God, are the great physician. You alone are Jehovah Rapha. You alone are the one who said to Moses, I am the Lord thy God who healeth thee. And God, we're not pleading for just physical healing. We're praying for emotional healing. God, we're praying for healing of the body, the mind, the spirit, the soul. We're praying for financial healing. God, we're praying for every kind of healing that we need. Any infirmity that dogs our trail. And then God, we would be remiss if we didn't say thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for watching over us. When danger was around us, God, thank you for being with us, God. Thank you, as David said, for placing angels around us. Thank you, God, for bringing us through our trials, through our troubles, God. When we look back over these years, we have to say thank you, God, that you've been good to us, God. Even when we didn't realize it, you were on our side. And so on this day, we decree and declare according to your word, in the name of Jesus, and according to his atoning blood on the cross, that we're healed, we're delivered, we're blessed, and we shall go forth. In Jesus' name, shout amen. Amen. Shout amen. Amen. And amen again. Now put your hands together and give God praise. He's worthy of our praise. He's worthy. Oh, yes, he is. All glory due to God, our Father, Jesus Christ, his Son. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. God be praised. Pray for our preacher today as we receive the word.
God, we thank you. We honor you, Lord God. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for our life, our health, and our strength. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your grace, Lord God, is deeper than my soul can see. Yes, sir.
My soul,
yeah, God. Thank you, God.
Can see.
I had a purpose, but it changed.
My purpose, yeah, God. Has been changed.
When I called out your
when
name.
I called out your name.
Why? Because you are mine.
I give
you
my love.
I give you my
all.
Let's sing it again. Your touch.
Your touch.
God, your kiss.
Your kiss.
Your grace.
Your grace.
Thank you for your grace, God. Nothing but your grace. It's deeper than my
it's
soul
deep.
Can see. Yeah, God. I feel your presence, God. Yes, God.
My soul.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Can see.
Yes, God. My purpose.
My
Come on, put your hands together and bless the name of Jesus. all over this house. If he is your love, come on and bless him. If he is your life, come on and bless him. Thank him for the blood. Thank him for the blood. Thank him for the blood.
Always a good thing to take a few minutes just to let God know how you feel. It's okay just to take a few minutes and tell God just how you feel. Amen. You always stand as we prepare for the word, stand for prayer. Oh, Lord God, as I stand before your people, God, I pray that with my mouth open, only your words will come forth. I pray, God, that you will speak through me all that you have given to me, that the body may be edified, Christ may be exalted, and you, our Father, be glorified. Bless someone this day that needs your healing. Need to be set free or need to be delivered. Do it, Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. For the time that I have with you, I will be reading the scripture from the book of Exodus, chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. Then we're going to drop down to 10, then read 13. It's coming from the NIV version. The word read is this. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites to turn back and encamp near Pi-Hahiroth, between Midol and the sea. They are to camp by the sea directly opposite of Baal-Zephon. Pharaoh will think, hold on to that, Pharaoh will think the Israelites are wandering around the land in confusion, hemmed in by the desert. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them. But I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and all his army. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So the Israelites did this. As Pharaoh approached the Israelites, looked up, There were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm. You will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only be still. I lift up for you today the promise for the subtopic, won't he do it? You may be seated. Amen. The promise, won't he do it? There's one thing that annoys me. I don't know about you, but one thing that really annoys me is when people make me promises. And it seems like they have no intentions on keeping them. Because when it comes time for them to fulfill the promise, they come up with this excuse or that excuse. But you know, after a while, I just get to the point, I just don't ask them to do anything for me. Have anybody experienced that? A person reneging on their promise. But if you read the word in Numbers 23 and 19, it says God is not a man that he should lie. He's not like us humans. Whenever he would change his mind. Whatever he said, he will see it through. In other words, he will do it. So in thinking about the promise, we have to go all the way back. All the way back to where the promise first started. And the promise started when God called Abraham. God called Abram. At that time, he was Abram. And he made him some promises. He said, look, Abram, I'm going to make you into a great nation. I'm going to bring your descendants back to this place. I'm going to bless you. And he said, here's something special. The entire world will be blessed through you. So as we begin to track this promise, Abram said to God, how will I then know that I'm going to receive it? The Lord said, well, then go get me a heifer and get me a ram. Get me a couple of turtle doves and some pigeons. And I want you to cut them in half. But the pigeons, leave them whole. And I want you to place them opposite of each other. A cut covenant. And what happened is that this is a cut covenant in the sense that when you make a vow, you make a promise, and you don't keep it. Back in that time, when you walk through the cut pieces and you don't keep your promise, the Bible says you will become as those cut pieces. Uh-huh. So God, in turn, allowed Abraham to go into a deep sleep. And then it says a smoking pot and a fiery torch appeared. And it went through the cut pieces. In other words, that was symbolic, representing God. Uh-huh. Because God wants to make sure that I am going to see this through. From the beginning to the end. I'm going to do what I know no other person is able to do. So it all began with him making the covenant with Abraham. And Abraham had some questions. He said, I don't have any heirs. How's this going to be? Yeah. He said, Eliezer is the servant, and I don't have any. And God said, Don't worry about all that. Don't worry about that. I'm going to provide you with an heir. He said, because you, your wife, at old age, is going to become pregnant. And she's going to have a son, and I want you to name him Isaac. Now, sometime when God make us promise, it becomes a little uncomfortable. I can imagine Abraham at 99 and Sarah at 90. And God is saying, you need to do what you know how to do. And everything is going to work out for you. And Abraham, by faith, said, I'll do it. I'll do just as you said. Although Sarah had a little problem with it. She laughed about it, but she ended up getting chastised, and the question was asked, Sarah, you know, what is too hard for God? Yeah, normally this would not be something that happened, but this is different. This is God who is saying it. So as we look through that, because the promise is going to flow through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So as we see, Sarah getting pregnant, she have Isaac, Then God tests Abraham's faith. Things get difficult. I'm telling you, sometimes things get hard when God make you a promise. Now, he made the promise to Abraham, but he turned around and told him, take Isaac up and sacrifice him. Oh, Lord, now I don't know about y'all, but I would have been a little bit uncomfortable, Reverend Steve, with that. Even though I know you made the promise, but oh, my God, I got to do everything within me to put my faith in you. Because now you're telling me to kill my son. But in the back of his mind, Abraham must have came to his senses, and his faith kicked in. He took Isaac up to Mount Moriah, laid him down. It was going to sacrifice him. Then God stepped in and said, don't touch him. Don't touch him. But go over there in the bushes and get that ram and sacrifice him. In other words, he was letting Abraham know, I'm not a man. I don't lie. I told you that a great nation was going to come through Isaac. Now, as the promise moves on, you got to try to move this promise. As the promise moves on, Isaac becomes older. Abraham becomes older. Abraham is there living in Canaan, and Abraham tells one of his servants, he said, listen, I need for you to go find Isaac a wife, because I do not want him to hook up with one of these Canaanite women. No. Now, y'all go and read that. Now, when you start to read that, then you'll find out what Abraham's concern was, because you know what would happen if he had hooked up with a Canaanite woman. That would have messed up the promise. Uh-huh. So he said, go find him a wife. So they went down to the relative's house, and they find Rebecca. Rebecca is Laban's sister. Y'all remember that name. We're going to mention it again. That's Laban's sister. And over time, Isaac met Rebecca. They hooked up, fell in love. Then things moved on. Rebecca gets pregnant with twins, Esau and Jacob. We got to move this promise on. Esau and Jacob. Now, as I called out the name, and you say the promise usually flow through the elder brother. So I said Esau and Jacob. But then the Bible says Jacob was holding on to Esau's heel. They said name of Jacob, because that means heel grabber. Jockeying for position. So even after they were born, Jacob did not stop his trickery, because he tricked Esau out of his birthright with some red stew. Lord have mercy. And then that wasn't enough. Him and his mother, in turn, while Isaac was old and going blind, they also knew that they needed the blessing from Isaac, from Abraham. So what do? They trick Isaac in thinking that Jacob is Esau. Because Esau is the one who is supposed to receive the blessing. So it worked. They tricked him, they dressed him up, tried to make him smell like Esau. He fell for it. He blessed him. Let me tell y'all something. When God make a promise, God will do whatever he have to do to bring it to fulfillment. That means when God make you a promise, God will sometimes look past your flaws. He'll look past your trickery. He'll look past your shortcoming. He'll look past all of that, because he has a plan for your life. And in this case, the promise and the covenant had to flow through Jacob. So now we see, since Jacob had tricked his brother, sometime down the road when it came time for him to get a wife, he went to a relative also. Went to Rebekah's brother. His name is Laban. So he goes and he sees Rachel and he asks to marry Rachel. Laban said, sure, you can marry Rachel. He said, but you got to work for 7 years before I give her to you. So he worked for Laban for 7 years. When the 7 years was up, he's all excited. He's ready to marry Rachel. But then Laban said, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. Wait a minute, I forgot something. Leah is the oldest. It wouldn't be right for me to let you marry Rachel. So you're going to have to marry Leah. Oh, my God. Look at that trickery catching up to him. Look at that trickery catching up to him. Now he got to work another 7 years. Now, I'm not trying to say anything that's not in the Bible, but the Bible said that Leah was hard on the eyes. Yeah. Hard on the eyes. Hard on the eyes. No. I didn't say that. The Bible said. My eyes were all, hard. But, he went to her tent at night. Leah produced six of the 12 siblings. Six of them. We're gonna leave Leah alone. Leah did what she was supposed to do. So now we're gonna keep this promise moving. Because now, as we move toward Jacob, here's one of the things I want you to keep in mind. Y'all read in the Bible where Jacob wrestled with God, right? Okay. Now the reason he was wrestling, he was anxious. He was a little concerned about something. And he was concerned that his actions from the past was going to catch up to him. Because it came time for him to meet up with his brother Esau. And in his mind, he thought Esau was going to kill him. So he went to God. And the Bible says he wrestled all night. God touched his hip, made him lame. But this is a reminder of how tough it is sometimes when you come to God in prayer, when you haven't trusted him, when you have done things according to your way, and you have ignored God's way. Sometimes you have to struggle just to get a prayer through. And Jacob, they end up in Canaan. Now we went through Abraham, went through Isaac, went to Jacob. Remember, one of the things that God promised Abraham, that after 400 years, his descendants will be in Egypt, and he would deliver them because he would hear their pain. He would see how they was mistreated. So you got to remember now that he promised Abraham land, he promised him descendants, he promised him a blessing. He promised him that the whole world would be blessed through him. And he promised him deliverance of the Israelites. Now, y'all wonder how the Israelites became God's people. They became God's people before they were even in existence by way of the promise. So now, as we move the promise along and we get to Joseph, Jacob's favorite son. Y'all can imagine why, because that's whose boy? That's Rachel's boy. Him and Benjamin, that's Rachel's boy. So he favored Joseph a little bit more. And he gave Joseph this cloak of many colors. And this started a problem because, Joseph wore that thing around and, he kind of taunted his brothers, they were doing well. They were doing all right with that. Until he had that dream. He had the dream, and he couldn't wait to get to his brothers. He said, let me tell you about my dream. And I had a dream that 11 stalks of wheat were standing, and one stalk of wheat was standing opposite of them. And the 11 stalks had to bow down to the one that was standing. The brother said, what you trying to say? What you trying to say, Joseph? You trying to say that we are going to bow down to you. But it got worse. The moon and the sun, they too are going to bow down. Now, Jacob got a problem. What you trying to say, Joseph? You trying to say me and your mother going to bow down to you? I'm only telling you what I dream. Now, here's what we got to grab from that. They call Joseph a dreamer. But in reality, God was getting ready to show him his gift. Because he wasn't just a dreamer. He was an interpreter of dreams. So we see that the promise led Joseph to the pit because his brothers got jealous. They threw him in the pit. And after time, the Ishmaelites came, took him out of the pit, and guess where they took him? Because this promise got the roll, y'all. It got the roll. Took him to Egypt. And took him to Egypt, Potiphar bought him. Now, the Bible say that Potiphar's house prospered as long as Joseph was there. All went well. But then Miss Potiphar came in. And she tried to pull some shenanigans with Joseph. Because the Bible said that Joseph was tall, dark, and handsome. Y'all know how we Joseph look. Yeah. Oh, no, no, Joseph. All right. All right. All right now. Yeah. So now, the promise leads Joseph to prison. While in prison, he meets the baker and the cupbearer. Now, you remember now, I told you he's not just a dreamer. He's using his gifts. So God, and the Bible say, look, your gifts will go before you. In other words, they'll make a way for you. Your gifts. So Joseph's gifts begin to make a way for him that's very intricate, very important to the movement of this promise. So now he told the cupbearer and the baker about their promise, about their dreams. In other words, he said, one of you, you're going to die, but you're going to be restored to your position. So he said to the cupbearer, when you are restored to your position, don't forget about me. Oh boy, here we go. We're humans. He was restored, and all of a sudden, he didn't even mention Joseph. Didn't say nothing to Pharaoh about Joseph. But Joseph remained steadfast. Even in prison, those around him was prospering. God was favored. Joseph was favored by God. Because God knew that it was only a matter of time before Joseph's gift would make room for him. All of a sudden, Pharaoh have a dream. He have a dream of 7 fatty calves and 7 real scrawny cows. And say that those little scrawny cows ate the fat cows. He say he had 7 stalks of wheat and 7 stalks of healthy wheat and 7 stalks of scorched wheat. And the scorched wheat ate the healthy wheat. So Joseph said to Pharaoh, the 2 dreams are 1 dream. It means that Egypt and the nation is going to have 7 years of plenty. And then 7 years of famine. So Joseph and his wisdom, they stored up all over the land. What did they do? They stored up the grain. In the wheat. They started up for 7 years. Now, here come a very important part of the promise. Because remember, what did God promise Abraham? That your descendants will be what? Enslaved in Egypt. So he had to use Joseph and his dreams to get the family to Egypt. So look who came to Egypt. Joseph's brothers, looking for food. Joseph recognized them, told them who he was. He said the devil meant it for bad, but God meant it for good. It doesn't matter that you threw me in the pit. I knew I was going to make it to the palace because my gift made room for me. Now I want you to go on back home. I'm not going to get into the whole story, but to just cut it. Go on home and get the rest of the family. Get my father and everybody and bring them here to Egypt. So they got the whole family and they brought them there. And then Joseph said this was done to preserve life. Yes, life had to be preserved because the Israelites had to make their way to Egypt. It started out with only 70 of them. Then they increased over the 400 years. Now, as we go over the 400 years, this is where we come to our scripture for the day. Now came time for God to send a deliverer. So he sent Moses. He said, go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Now Pharaoh was hard-headed because he figured they have all their gods. I ain't worried about you. I call on my gods. I want to tell y'all something about God and his humor. You know when God rained down the plagues on Egypt? Did y'all know that one of those plagues was a plague of frogs? Let me tell you something about that plague of frogs. One of the Egyptians' gods was a frog god. Y'all didn't get that. Y'all didn't get that. Y'all didn't get that. He rained down upon them thousands of what they worship. Because God wanted to make for sure that everybody knew that he was the one and only true living God. So after the plagues came, and he had to plague Egypt with the death of the firstborn. The Passover is very important. That's when death passed over the Israelites after they put the blood on their door. So now, after Pharaoh let them go, they were about 3 days away when we get to this scripture. They're down the road about 3 days. Then they look and say, you know what? We made a mistake. We let these Israelites go. We shouldn't have let them go. We got to go and bring them back. Now, the Bible said that the angel was moving in front of the Israelites. And the cloud was moving in front of the Israelites. But then God said he told the angel to move to the rear. And then the cloud moved to the rear. Something about to happen. Y'all see what I said here? That God had them to travel in a direction that made Pharaoh thought that what? They were confused. And because he thought they were confused, they figured it was a good time for them to overtake them. Let me tell y'all something. When God is meeting your promises, sometimes you don't even understand what God is doing. Because the Bible says his ways are high above our ways. And we cannot even comprehend his thinking. So as you look at what's happening, and as they head out toward the Red Sea, look at this. It says now the Israelites, here's a mistake I don't want y'all to make. The Israelites look back, and they saw Pharaoh and his army coming. They got scared. They start complaining. But here's the problem. Didn't I just tell y'all that God moved the angel to the back? Didn't I tell y'all that he moved the cloud to the back? So that means that God, in the form of the cloud, was standing in between the enemy and the Israelites. But here's the problem. The Israelite chose to look past God. Y'all in here. That's a mistake we make. After God has delivered us from something, then we run into some trouble. We start looking back to where he brought us from. But to do that, you got to look past God. Past what God has done. before you can even see your enemies. So that's when Moses told him, don't worry about your enemies. Be still and see God's salvation. Because this is the last time you're going to see them. This put me in reminder. I was watching National Geographic. They had an episode about eagles. And eagles is kind of symbolic of having power, strength, wisdom, speed. And they said that the crow is the only bird foolish enough to attack an eagle. They say while the eagle flies, the bird would come down, light on his back, start nagging, pecking at him. So the eagle don't waste any time trying to, you know, flip him off. The eagle just fly higher. And then the eagle fly higher. Then the eagle fly higher. Then he get to a place where the air now is a little thin. And the crow can't survive. So he has to fall off. In other words, he has to fall back. Isn't that the way God is? That when you walk with God and you trust God, you can take wings like an eagle and you can fly higher. You take your prayer life higher. Take your worship higher. Understand, take your love higher. There's nothing you can't do. Now we're almost done with this promise. We done made it through the land. And now they're on their way to the promised land. We got one more part of the promise that we got to talk about. He said to Abraham that you're going to be a blessing to the entire world after 42 generations. Something happened. God himself stepped down from heaven in the form of a little baby. And they named him Jesus. And Jesus, the Bible says Jesus, grew up in stature and in favor among God and men. Jesus had a job to do. He had one more enemy he had to fight. That's because that enemy was standing in the way of God and mankind, was keeping man from being redeemed, was keeping God from reconciling with the human. So God, so Jesus took sin on his back. He became sin. Took it to a place where it became irrelevant, where it can't get in the way no more. He took it straight to the cross where we don't have to worry about it. Ain't you glad that Jesus took sin to the cross? Because remember now, that's the last part of the promise. Because we're on our way to a new promised land. We are going to another promised land. Because of what Jesus did, we could escape the fiery hell. But now we know that although the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life. We have eternal life. And we are pilgrims on our way, on our way to the promised land. But all right, brothers and sisters, buckle up. Because while you're on your way, just like the Israelites, do you know what happened after they crossed the Red Sea? They had 10, count them in about 10 nations. They had to defeat in order to take over the promised land. Understand this, my sisters and brothers. While we're on our way, we are on our way to the promised land. In this world, we're going to face some hell. We face the hell of cancer. We face the hell of lupus. We face the hell of rejection. As a matter of fact, it put me in mind of a song. Where the songwriter said, I almost let go. I felt like I couldn't take life anymore. My problems had me bound. Depression weighed me down. But God held me close so I wouldn't let go. His mercy, it kept me so I wouldn't let go. Then the writer said, I almost gave up. I was right at the edge of a breakthrough, but I couldn't see it. Oh, the devil had me. But Jesus came and grabbed me, and he held me close, so I wouldn't let go. So yes, my brothers and sisters, you're going to go through some hell here on earth. But according to the word of God, don't be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about anything. But with prayer and supplication to Thanksgiving, along with supplication, make your request known to God. Here's the important part. Then he said he'll guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. So while you're going through your hell, peace become your healing. They say, I'll bestow a peace upon you that surpasses all understanding. You won't be able to understand it. Your enemies won't be able to understand it. But let me tell you something. It gives you the power to keep pressing your way. Because no matter what you're going through, no matter how big it is, it cannot penetrate God's peace. If you just simply stay right there, you'll be all right. Because God himself will be your help. It's all because of Jesus. Then you have to do something else. Because God is God in your heart. He's strengthening you. You got to tell somebody it's not just for you. Somebody is waiting to hear about this God that rescued you. You got to tell them that Jesus is the Son of God. And he died for the remission of sins. And if you trust him, if you accept him, you will be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes shall not perish. All of this is because God made a promise and he fulfilled it. He took it all the way to the end, y'all. Now we can say, won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Yeah. And that's our testimony. Let me tell y'all, when it's all said and done, guess what, my brothers and sisters? We win. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You might as well praise him. Hallelujah. Won't he do it? He will deliver. God will deliver on his promise. Do you have any witnesses in the house that the Lord will deliver on his promises? Hallelujah. However long it takes, whatever you have to go through, whatever we have to struggle with, God will deliver on his promise. He will do what he promised he will do and what he said he will do. You ought to give God praise for Minister Smith this morning. Powerful message. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Praise God for the man of God today who preached from his soul. Amen. And he reminded us as he came to his concluding climax that it is Jesus Christ who is the ultimate of the promise. And there's a song that says that all we have to do is look and live. It was in that desert that the same Moses he preached about told the people if they needed healing to look to the serpent and they could be healed. It was not the serpent healing them, but it was their faith that healed them. And if there's someone here today after hearing this word, whether you are in person or streaming, maybe you have dealt with situations where people have been counterfeit in their promises. But let me tell you, what the Lord promises you,
He will fulfill. The Lord promises you life more abundantly. He promises you that he will be with you always, even until the end of the ages. We remind people this as they stand in the waters of baptism. Jesus' great command that I'll be with you always until the end of the ages. That's a promise. And God said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. That's a promise. And if you can believe on his promise for your life, you can be saved today. Amen. We can't save you. No church can save you. But Jesus can save you. And all you have to do is believe him and trust him. As we sing today, if God has touched your heart, pray that prayer of faith. Ask Jesus into your heart. Let him know that you love him. Let him know that you want to know more about him, but that you simply believe that he is your Lord and Savior. And you will profess it with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. And my Bible says you are saved. Amen. And then you need to come and unite with the church. Be a part of the fellowship of believers. This is family for you, that you may come. I've a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. A message, oh my friend, for you. It's recorded. It's recorded in the word. Hallelujah. Jesus said it, and I know it's true. Look and live. Look and live. Oh, look to Jesus now and live. Oh, it's recorded in his word. Hallelujah. And it's only him that you look. Jesus told me in his word. Hallelujah. His blood will cleanse a sin-sick soul. I believe in his word. Hallelujah. I'm a witness. Made me whole. Come on, look and live. My sister, live. Look to Jesus now and live. Oh, it's recorded in his word. Hallelujah. And it's only him to look at. Jesus gave to us a key. Hallelujah. In the Garden of Gethsemane. If you tell him on your knees, hallelujah, he will hear you and will give you ease. Come on, look and live. My brother, live. Look to Jesus. Jesus now and live. Oh, it's recorded in his word. Hallelujah, it is only to look at. Look and live, my sister. Look and live. My sister, live. Look to Jesus. Look to Jesus now and live. Oh, it's recorded in his word. Hallelujah, it is only that you look at. Hallelujah. Give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. I pray that someone has made that decision today to follow the Lord. Amen. And whether you are worshiping remotely, streaming, or in person, you are still a part of the body of Christ. Amen. If you made that decision, please let us know about it. Today, if you're here in the house, just let one of the deacons or the ministers know. If you are streaming, call a number that we will make available to you. Be in touch with us so that we can personally minister to you and let you know that we welcome you into the family of God. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Give God praise for the word again today. Amen. And we want to thank God for those who are visiting with us, who filled out a card. Sister Dolores Wilson, God bless you. Give God praise for her today. Her home church is Grace Apostolic Church in Nashville, Tennessee. Amen. God be praised. In fact, I was just with some folk from Nashville, Tennessee, this past week. And also Lamont Wilson, amen. God be praised for your being here today at Concord Church. And we'll be praying for you and praying for the angel of your house and for all that God is doing, the great work down there in Tennessee, amen. We're so grateful to the Lord for how he works. There are saints everywhere, amen, amen. And it's good to know that the Lord's work is done. Listen, don't believe everything you hear on TV about the church dying and all this stuff. Listen, we are the body of Christ, amen. We are the living body of Christ, saints in the Lord, saved, sanctified, amen. And witnesses for his truth on our way to glory, amen. And so let us continue to be witnesses to God's truth. And it's always good to welcome our brothers and sisters whom God has placed in other areas and vineyards. God be praised. I want you to continue to pray this week for all that is transpiring here at Concord Church. Remember, tomorrow we will celebrate the life of Brother Robert Drake here at the church. His wake is 10, service at 11. Pray for his family as we begin the week. The Lord bless you. So good to see you. And anointed praise, thank you. And our wonderful young people in the generation. Reverend Danielle, who's away, and all of you. Thank you, Minister Walika, and all of you for all of your leadership. And thank you, brother. You preach today. Amen. 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 And amen. And I tell you, you preach about Joseph, because that's your name. You know Joseph. Amen. God bless you today. Let's prepare. God bless you, anointed praise. We thank you for fulfilling every promise you have made. And we pray that as we go forth this week and this day, and as we journey in life, that we will know that every promise you've made will be fulfilled. Teach us to trust you when we come before the waters, to know that the waters cannot overtake us. For you will even divide the waters, and we will walk on dry land. So unto you, O God, our Father, Christ, our Savior, the Holy Spirit who indwells in us, be with us in every household, we pray. Lead us as witnesses to your truth wherever we go. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Go in peace.
Thank you for joining us for worship today at Concord Baptist Church of Boston, located in Milton, Massachusetts. If you're new to Concord Church or new to the faith, we are here to assist and guide you on your journey. Please reach out to us at cbcboston.org/contact us. That's cbcboston.org/contact us. Access to our online, midweek, and weekend ministries and activities may be found on our Facebook page or the church's website. Just search Concord Baptist Church of Boston. On behalf of Pastors Reverend Drs. Conley and Maureen Hughes and the entire Concord Church family, God bless you and have an amazing and blessed week.